This is Jeff Perlman, founder and CEO of Xojo, and in this video, I'm going to show you how to query a database. So in order to show you how to query a database, what we're ultimately going to do is build this little app here. It's got a field where you can type in a name, you can press search, and then see the results below. So I'm going to type in, for example, Tyler and press return. It finds Barbara Tyler because it's searching first name and last name. I can type in a first name like Grace. There's Grace. I can type in Jordan. There's two Jordans. So this is basically the app that we're going to create to query a database. Now, just as a reminder, while I'm doing this in a desktop project, the code would be virtually identical in a web project, and I will show you that at the end. So I'm going to be using the project that I completed in the last video. That video is called Connecting to a Database. If you haven't watched that video, go watch that one first before watching this one. So the first thing we'll do is build the user interface. So I'm going to go to the layout editor, and let's grab a field, put that on the layout. And we'll grab a button for doing the search. I'm going to call that search. There we go. And then I'm going to grab a list box. We'll position that. Okay, now list box needs to be two columns because we're going to show first name and last name. So I'll make it two columns, and then I'm going to go to initial value and put the column title. So first name, hit tab, last name. There we go. Okay, so the interface is ready. The next thing we need to do is write a method to query the database. So I'm going to add a method to the window, and I'm going to call it queryDB. Now, this is going to get called every time we query the database, and it's going to do the query and then put the results into that list box we created. So since we could call it over and over again, each time we do it, the first thing we want to do is get rid of any results that were already there. So I'm going to put listbox1.removeAllRows. So that clears the first thing, clears the list box of any results. Now, when you do a query, the results come back in something called a row set. That just holds the results of the query. So I'm going to make a variable called rows found as row set so I can hold the results. And then now we're going to do the query and set the query set rows found equal to the results of the query. The database connections in the app class. So I'm going to put rows found equals app.db. That's our connection. And I'm going to call the database's SQL select command. And we'll put our select statement in. Now, at first, I'm going to keep this really simple. I'm going to put select star from customers. So basically, just select all the rows in the customers table. And the next thing we need to do is we need to go through the rows that we found and add them to the list box. Now, fortunately, the row set class has something in it called an iterator. An iterator just makes it easy to loop through all of the rows, get one row each, and then get the results, or get the column values from that row and do something with them. In this case, put them in a list box. So we're going to use the for each loop. And instead of doing something like I as integer, we can define a variable, in this case row, as a database row. And then we put in rows found. So this is going to go through each row in rows found, put the row into the row variable so we can access it. All right, so next we're going to add a row to the list box. And what we're going to add are the two columns from row. So I'm going to put row.column, give it the row name, first name. And it's a string value in this case, comma, row.column. Last name dot string value. Okay, so we're using the row property, or rather the row variable. We are getting the columns first name and last name, getting the string values, passing them to add row to add them to the list box, and then finally we do next. All right, so before we can test this out, we need to call this method somehow. So I'm going to go back to the window. I'm going to double click on the search and use the pressed event and call my queryDB method. Great, now we're ready to try this. Press run. Now because I'm on a Mac and because my connection code is accessing the desktop to get to the database. It's asking me if I have permission. You won't see this on Windows, but you do see it on a Mac. You'll see this each time you run, but when you build the application to give to a user, they would only see this the first time they run it on a Mac. After that, they would never see it again. It's just an OS thing for permissions on the Mac. All right, so there's our window. I'll press search, and there it is. There's all our rows from the database. Great. So the next thing we want to do is make it so that we can type a first name or a last name in the field and have it search on that rather than just displaying all the rows. So let's go back and we'll go to our QueryDB method. And the first thing we need to do is we need to change the SQL call itself. It needs a where clause. So I'm going to put where first name equals, and the question mark is a placeholder for a value. And then I'll put or last name equals. And again, we can put in that placeholder for value. Now we need to pass in the values that'll go where those question marks are. So I'm going to put a comma, and the text field is just called text field one since we didn't spend any time naming it. So I'll put text field one.text. And again, text field one.text. Because we're in either case, for the first name or last name, we want to search using the values in the text field. So it's going to pass those in, basically replacing the question mark with whatever you typed in the field. Now, that should be enough to make this work. So let's give it a try. All right, so I'm going to try, let's try Grace. That's a first name. Yep, there's Grace. And how about Ferris? Oh, there's two Ferrises. Okay. And Jordan, that works. Let's try a last name, Duncan. Duncan. Okay, so it's searching on first name and last name. Great. Now, just like when we were connecting to the database in the last video, we need to do some error checking. Because, for example, this SQL statement, maybe we made a mistake. Something could go wrong. The database could be offline, that sort of thing. So we're going to use that same method for checking for errors, try catch. So I'm going to put try and then catch error as database exception. And if anything goes wrong, I'm going to beep message box. Something went wrong with the search. And try. Okay, this way it's going to try to do the SQL select and get the rows back and then iterate through. But if something goes wrong, then the exception will fire and it'll do some error checking. Or in this case, it will tell the user that something went wrong. Now, chances are the only reason this would happen is if the database went offline, like if you're doing if you're using a server-based database. But it's just a good idea in general for things like this to put in some error checking. So as I mentioned in the beginning, the code's virtually the same if you do it in a web project. So here's a web project. I've got a web page. I've created the same interface. I've got all the same setup. Here's my QueryDB method. The only difference is I had to change from app.db to session.db because the connection's on the session rather than the app. That's because we want the connection to be different for each user, so each user is doing different query results and that kind of thing. And that's really the big change. I removed system.beep as well from the error checking from the catch section because that's not something that works in a browser. But aside from that, everything else is exactly the same. If I hit run, it's going to build the app and launch the browser. There's my interface, and I can type in a name, if I can type it right. There we go. Okay, and we did Ferris, and I can type in Jordan. So you can see that it works exactly the same in a web app. So that's the basics about how you query a database. Obviously, you could make this more sophisticated, and you can learn more about SQL if you're not super familiar with SQL and learn how to do more things with SQL. But this is the basics. Next, what you want to do is watch the next video, which will be updating a database. And that video will show you how to get the rows, stick them into individual fields so you can make modifications, save them back to the database, delete, etc., that kind of thing. To learn more about Xojo, Click below to subscribe to this channel, check out the other videos, and visit Xojo.com.